God. Jeremiah chapter number 2, verse number 13. For my people have committed two evils. Number one, they have forsaken me, the fountain of living water. Number two, they have hewn them out cisterns, broken cisterns that can hold no water. Amen. My people have committed two evils. They have forsaken, or we could say they have abandoned, me, the fountain of living waters. So here we have Jeremiah, and he is sharing a metaphor. And the metaphor is this, is that you have two things, and they're side by side. You have a wonderful fountain flowing with good, fresh water. And then you have a broken cistern that is holding water that is old and that is stale and that is contaminated. He says this, he said, my people, they've committed two evils. Number one, they've forsaken me, the fountains of a living water. And the second thing they've done is they've built for themselves cisterns. And not only are they cisterns, but they are broken cisterns, which can hold no water. As we look at this, these cisterns are containers that just doesn't have the ability to hold water well. They are stagnant, they are sturdy, dirty, they are stale. And the people, they're building these. And in this day and age, they would build these cisterns by the wall where they would be brick and they would be lined with this brick and with this mortar. But after some time, the brick would fall, the mortar would fall, and where would it fall? But into the water. The bricks are falling, the mortar is cracked and broken, and so all of a sudden the water begins to seep away. Not only is it not fresh water flowing in and out, we know that that's what creates healthy water, right? A good input, but a good output. All it is a container where there's something coming in, and not regularly, and there is nothing going out, so it is dirty, it is nasty, it is putrid, and it's broken, and it's not even holding the water well. And so God says, my people, they have committed two evils, because here they are beside each other, and there's one that is very good, but the message is this, that they're not choosing the good. This was the message of Jeremiah's day. He was preaching the Word of God. However, people didn't want to hear the Word of God. They wanted their own message. They wanted their own thing. And so they built for themselves what they wanted. We need a Word from God for our lives. Amen. You may notice, and I don't get up here and browbeat other ministries. But let me just say something for a moment. There is a point in our life where we have to be very careful what ministries we follow. When folks don't accept the Old Testament or they feel that it has gone out, there's something wrong when you don't take the whole Word of God, because all of God's Word is applicable. There, and I'm not going to name names this morning. I'm simply saying there are some big ministries that will only preach the New Testament. We need a balance of both. We will never fully understand the New Testament if we don't understand the Old Testament. There are some ministries that will say that there is a way of salvation for the Jews, and then there's a way of salvation for the Gentiles. That is not in accordance to the Word of God. Amen. So we need to be careful which wells that we are drinking from, because when they don't preach the cross and Jesus crucified, amen, we will find that it is a different gospel, it is a foreign gospel, and it is contrary to the Word of God. Amen. We need the cross of Jesus Christ. Let me tell you what Jesus did in hell. Amen. And I'm not going to go into all the details. We can talk later. What he did in hell will never equate to what he did on the cross. Amen. The blood of Jesus Christ is what saves us. Amen. It is the atoning work. And so here it is. People, they laughed at Jeremiah's message. Amen. They could have had God, but they turned to their own methods. Amen. To meeting the deep needs of their life. You know what? You and I have deep needs in our life, every one of us. And God's design and plan is to meet the deep needs of our life. We can either choose Him, amen, as He wants, or we can be as the people in Jeremiah's day and say, well, I'm going to do it my own method. You know what that's like? When you say, I'm going to do it my way in meeting my needs, it's saying to God, God, I'm forsaking the fountains of a living water. And I'm going to build my own cistern. And you know what our cisterns are like? They're like broken cisterns that are dirty and putrid and doesn't have the ability to hold water. And so God was very upset with the people of Israel. Amen. The first truth is this that we find is that all of us are thirsty. Every one of us were designed in our life to have a thirst. We thirst for purpose. We thirst and we want to thrive in the middle of love. We want peace. We want freedom. Every one of us have a down deep thirst for that in our life. Every one of us has a thirst. So what are we going to do to quench that thirst? God says, I have a well of everlasting water. Or you have the choice of building broken cisterns. How will you quench your thirst? And so every one of us want in our life to have that purpose. We want to find out what is our, if you would, for a lack of a better term, what is our destiny to finding the purpose of our life?
Amen.
We have a thirst for it. Every one of us in here want love. You can say, I'm unlovable, I don't want love. You know what? And you're lying and deceiving yourself. We were designed to love and be loved. Every one of us need freedom. Every one of us need peace. See, I think that the best way that we can look at how do I find that love? How do I find that purpose? How do I find that peace? How do I find that freedom? Is we have to understand that we were created by God. So if God created me with a need of this love and peace and freedom, then God, how do I get it? How do I get it? And God says, simple. I provided for you a fountain of a living water. Why do we have so many problems in our society with relationship after relationship? You look even at the woman at the well. Relationship after relationship, she was thirsty for love. She wanted acceptance. She wanted a relationship. And Jesus said, you don't need to look anywhere else, but I will provide the love that you need. Amen. I will give you the quench to your thirst. Every one of us want love. Why is there an epidemic of drugs? Have you noticed that in society, if you've not worked around a doctor's office or you've not looked at the news, you may notice that there's a big crackdown on narcotics being prescribed. The reason why that is because folks get addicted to it. And so folks are looking for something. They're thirsty. So drugs, whether prescription or whether they find it somewhere else, relationship, drinking, whatever that is, they are looking for something that can only be found in God. And when they look somewhere else, it is a broken cistern. You see, we aren't really different than those in Jeremiah's day. The only thing is they were busy digging cisterns, but we are busy digging cisterns, but we have lots more resources. Amen, lots more resources. Have you ever thought about this? We live in a day and hour in which folks don't know what to do if they don't have entertainment. I mean, what do you do if you don't have television or a DVD player? What do you do if you don't have a cell phone service? Or what if you don't have a good radio connection? Or what do you do if you don't have a DVD? You know why folks can't listen to God? It's because there's so many other voices, they never have a quiet moment to hear the voice of God. When's the last time that we just stopped and we were able to hear the crickets chirping and the birds singing in the tree or the rustling of the wind and the breeze in the air or we hear the roar of water? Amen. God wants us to stop and hear His voice, but we're too busy digging so much entertainment, and it can even be Christian entertainment. We have DVDs and we have CDs galore. stop us from hearing the true voice of God if we don't stop.
Yes.
And so we dig cisterns, so busy with everything. God, help us to stop and find the fountain of living water. There's three things I want to look at quickly this morning. And that is the first is the flavor of the cisterns. Cisterns. You know, water and cisterns taste lousy. Let's talk about what cisterns are for a few moments. Any of you ever, some of you old timers may know this a little bit better. Any of you old timers ever at your drain or on your roof take a bucket to catch the water that falls? And maybe you use it to water your plants or whatever it may be. Okay? Anyone know anything about that? Or any of you know anything about where I grew up in West Virginia? I love, Brother Dennis, a good spring that you could get a drink from. Now, don't lose out with me. I know some of you may say, Brother Saville, that sounds pretty disgusting. But Brother David, there in the mountain, down below from our barn, on a good hot summer day, I knew that when I was working in the hay field, and you have all that dry hay flying around, it's going in every crevice of your body, into the back part of your throat, all you want, Sister Tina, is some water. Now, I knew that in the hay field, there was a cistern. We had a great big old clay pot of a thing where the cows could drink. But Sister Rachel, it was only because it caught water from the rain. And you can look in there and there'd be bugs floating around, there'd be frogs jumping, and it was really, really warm. I was never, ever, ever tempted to go and drink from the cistern. Never, never. As thirsty as I was, I would go without Brother David. But I knew at the base of the mountain, down the hill from the barn, if I would just walk the cow path down there, that there was a big old pipe coming out of the mountain, and there was the freshest, coolest, most refreshing spring water that I could ever, ever, ever want. The only thing that I ever found comes close to it is the Sani water. Amen. Those minerals in that water, it is just amazing, Brother Walt. I still love the taste of that water. And I get down, and boy, I just open up my mouth and let that pipe put it in. And there's times where maybe someone was at the pipe. I'd go down there where the stream was coming out from that pipe, and I would just pick it up in my hands. It was wonderful water because it was fresh. You know, that's what God has provided for us in the fountain of living water. He said they've forsaken the fountains of living water and they have hewn themselves out cisterns. Cisterns, the flavor of the cistern, it tastes lousy. It's bitter. It's terrible. It's stagnant. It's warm. It's just awful to drink. And I want you to know that when we choose to go outside the method that God has prescribed for us through Him to drink of His Word and finding love and finding purpose and finding peace and finding freedom, when we go outside of His ways and we use our own methods and we dig our cisterns, all it is lousy water that we drink from. Let me tell you, I think the best marriage counseling I can give anybody is fall in love with Jesus. You can marriage counsel yourself out your ears, but until you get right with Jesus and you fall in love with Jesus and you find a love relationship with Him, He'll help every other love relationship. As much as I love my wife and I would die for her, as she cannot provide for me what God has designed to provide for me. But when I find in God, amen, our marriage is so much sweeter. Amen. I can have lots of friends. How can you have lots of friends and still feel lonely? Because you can't find those answers for the deep part of your soul in friends. They can only be found in Christ. Amen. You're hewing yourself out cisterns. Amen. You try to entertain yourself. And you try to find funny. You try to laugh. You try to find that place of quietness. And I'm not saying some things God cannot work through. But if you're looking for the tool more than you are the one who created the tool, amen, you're hewing yourself out cisterns, and it's going to be very bitter to drink from. So the flavor of the cistern is terrible. But oh, when you drink of Christ. He told the woman at the well, I'll give you water to drink that you'll never thirst again. But yes, when you drink of Him, amen, He's the one that can help us hold our head up high when everything's going wrong. He's the one who can give us, amen, confidence and peace even when we don't like the situation. Amen. Because we've learned to drink from Him and not from our own methods. Listen, it's not any different than Jeremiah's day. Jeremiah's preaching, nobody wants to hear. They're not accepting the gospel. They're not accepting the word of God. Our world would be a lot different today if folks started drinking from the well of the living water instead of from cisterns that they have dug. So the flavor of the cistern is terrible. And then I look at the filthiness of the cistern. Any of you ever look in those buckets that's like below the spouting of the house where that water was? Does it look like it's fresh and crystal clear? It may look good at the top. It may initially, but you look down in there, you'll see all kinds of dirt. You'll see some bugs floating around, squirming. You'll see all types of bacteria, all types of bad things. Let me just tell you, it is my recommendation that you do not drink that water because it will make you sick. Now, can I bring it to the spiritual side and say this? When we drink from the things that we've made, listen, God still honors holy living. When we say, I'm going to do it my way, I'm going to do it my way. It's doing me sick. The filthiness of the cisterns. See, it's a different story. Wholeness and health only come from the fountain. Brokenness, sickness, hurting, pain comes from the cistern. So this morning, if you've been digging a cistern for things in your life, for whatever area of that your life that it is, if you've been doing it by your own method instead of by God's method, I want to tell you it's not a healthy way to live. It's a good way to get sick. So the filthiness of the cistern. So we've looked at the flavor of the cistern, the filthiness of the cistern, but the failure of the cistern. Jeremiah not only said, was God's people forsaking the fountains of living water, but they were taking themselves to cisterns, but they were broken cisterns. They just did not have the ability to hold water. They weren't doing a good job to hold it to begin with, and then they were broken, so it really wasn't doing a good job to hold it. Hey, the Word of God tells us that the pleasures of sin are but for a season. There are pleasures in sin, but it is not a long-term pleasure. So it is broken. It just doesn't work. You can fix it and think that you're feeling good for a while. Well, I dug my own cistern. I'm doing it my own way with my own method. I'm finding love. I'm finding peace. I'm finding freedom. I'm finding a joy. Well, you may, but I need to tell you that your method is still broken. It's only going to last for a little bit of time, and then it's gone. But at the fountain of living water that God has provided, it's eternal. It's everlasting. So in your busyness of life, and we're all busy, but if you're too busy to resource to the fountain of God, the only way that our families will work is when we're drinking at the fountain of living water. The only way our marriages will work is when we're drinking at the fountain of living water. The only way our soul will thrive and be healthy is when we're drinking at the fountain of living water. The only way to find real purpose and meaning in our life is when we're drinking at the fountain of living water. I can have whatever a label placed on me entitled, it will never give me the satisfaction that God will give me when I drink at His fountain. You can be the president. You can be the CEO. You can be the top executive. You can be the owner. You can have all the polished titles you want. But for that, it'll only be temporary. But when you find yourself in Christ, it is eternal. It is eternal. The psalmist David said,
that at thy right hand are pleasures forevermore.
Amen.
Not just a day or a week or a month or a year, but forevermore. Charlie, if you come to the piano this morning and play whatever. I just want to challenge you. By what methods are you living by? Are you living by methods that you've come up with, systems that you've done? Or are you living by the method of the fountain of living water? That's where purpose is. That's where love is. That's where peace is. That is where freedom is. You may say, Pastor, you're preaching to a bunch of Christians. Exactly. The message Jeremiah was preaching was to God's people, Israel. But if we're not careful, the methods of our life can start being our own instead of God's. So this morning, can I ask you in this service to evaluate your heart and your mind by what methods you're living by? If you're living by the cisterns of water that doesn't have good flavor, that is filthy, that is made for failure, then can I have you this morning draw from the well of everlasting water, the fountains of the living water, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's gather in this morning. Let's evaluate our methods and draw from the well of the living water. Everyone that would, from this prayer this morning.
Thank you.